Hello, I'm happy to be joined with Julia Taliesin from the Somerville Journal once again for another Somerville Media Center, Somerville Journal News Roundup. How are you doing, Julia?
I'm okay today. Thanks, Dave. How are you?
Hanging in there. Hanging in there. We usually start off these segments with an update from you with COVID-19 numbers. Numbers of cases and testing. So why don't we just start off with that?
Absolutely. So the most recent numbers I've got at the moment, and they are ever changing, were updated yesterday morning. And so the most recent May 12th in the morning. The most recent cases are, have been 712 people who have tested positive, 420 people have recovered, and there have been 17 confirmed fatalities so far. One thing to keep in mind is as the city has been expanding testing, because initially CHA testing was only available to patients, now it is Somerville residents. They're also in the process of opening up a clinic in East Somerville. We should expect to see these numbers go up, not necessarily because it is suddenly spreading faster, but because there's more testing. So that's something to keep in mind. I did also recently check in with CHA. And so far as of May 11th, they have tested 3,523 people in Somerville and 160 in Cambridge. So the testing effort has been concentrated in Somerville at the moment. There are other clinics doing testing in Cambridge. So that does not represent all the testing in Cambridge. And I have been getting a lot of questions about who should be tested, especially now that testing access has expanded and it is no longer just CHA patients. So I reached out to CHA and they told me that people should consider getting tested if they were recently exposed to a positive COVID person. They live in a house with someone or other people who have been positive or who are positive and they feel that they may have been exposed, or it's been recommended that they receive testing from their doctor, from a nursing, an urgent care center, et cetera. However, for most people, if you have limited your contact with people and have mostly remained at home, been quarantining, been practicing, you know, really stringent social distancing and sanitation protocols when you go out to grocery shop, they do not recommend that you get tested because the risk of exposure is pretty low. But it is just something to keep in mind that if you do think you may have been exposed, they do encourage you to call. So you don't have to have, you don't need to fit a CDC profile anymore. So that's the kind of idea of expanding testing, that there's not a stringent like kind of restrictions on who can be tested. So if you think you've been exposed, definitely call. They do tell you have to call. I don't have the phone number pulled up at the moment, but we do have several articles up about this and you can look on their website. You do have to call and make an appointment. So it's not just show up, but it is drive-by. So all you got to do is call, make an appointment. They'll ask you a few questions and then you can drive, you can walk, you can bike up and get tested for COVID-19. So that's kind of the picture of testing and cases in Somerville at the moment. The other thing I wanted to mention on the kind of COVID-19 front has to do with masks. So recently, I think, God, what is time? So many things are happening every day. Yeah. I think a week and a half ago or 2 weeks ago, the city got a hold of about 4,000 masks that they had distributed out throughout the city to seniors in public and private housing, in assisted living, and as well as to disabled residents in those places. But also around the same time, they put in a mask order that everyone age 2 and over needs to wear a mask when they're out in public. And some people were a little bit upset, confused, because they're like, how can you be mandating a mask order if you're not going to be distributing masks to everyone and making sure that people have access? So one thing that the mayor has mentioned is that it took, even just to secure those 4,000 masks, it took a long time. It took weeks to get them secured, to have them shipped here. So he, you know, in the beginning, he was like, we're working on getting more, but it's going to take some time. But last week, they were able to secure 100,000 masks, a lot of masks, which they have been distributing throughout the city of Somerville. They have staff distributing them at schools where there are meal pickups happening. They have Somerville police distributing them at three locations twice a day, 5 days a week throughout the city. They also have police have them. So if you're not wearing a mask and a police person might pull you over, they have masks that they can give out to people who are not wearing them, which is really important, especially since that since the Somerville order went into effect, there was a statewide order that went into effect. And now the state required, everyone in the state is required to wear a mask out in public. So this is just something to keep in mind that if you are struggling to find a mask, that they are available. But the other side of this is that while the city has said, we have masks, come get masks, we want to support you, they've also issued a request for 10,000 homemade masks from the community. And the reason for this is because the masks that the city is distributing are your standard kind of three-ply face masks with, you know, the little elastics over the ears, which are good, but they're a lot less durable than homemade fabric masks. And they obviously can't be washed in your washing machine. They have to kind of be worn and then thrown away. So the city is aware that while this is a good step in, you know, improving access, that it's not really a sustainable step. So they have issued a request. There are already people working hard. There is a group in Prospect Hill and many more who have been making thousands of masks for CHA and other health organizations. And I think end of last week, the city said they had already received 1,100 masks. So people are already banding together to get this done so that the city can start distributing more kind of durable, sustainable, washable masks for people to wear. So if you can make a mask, they need them. Many people do at the moment. So definitely if you have skill with the sewing machine or even just basic skill with the sewing machine and want to hear from someone how to do it, there are people you can reach out to. And the city needs your help. So if you need masks, you can get them. If you can make masks, people need them. So that's kind of where we're at right now.
That's a great update. And, you know, we were talking earlier about the messaging coming from Cambridge Health Alliance and the messaging coming from the city. The city wants testing for all or is advocating testing for all. And then like you'd mentioned that CHA is saying wait, you know, get tested if these conditions are present.
Absolutely. So one thing actually to add to that is I think part of just, you know, kind of hearing a lot of the, you know, the city's messaging, which they have partnered, you know, closely with CHA on a lot of it. The other part of this is that Somerville has implemented a whole tracing initiative, a contact tracing initiative, so that when you call and get tested, even if you test negative, there is a team of volunteers and a team of nurses who are going to be following up with you and following up with you if you test positive to try to figure out and contain, but also track like where this virus is going, how it's moving in this community. So I think that also is kind of at the root of like everyone get tested, is so that we have a better idea of like who is tested in our community. But, you know, for example, I have been in my home. I've really quarantined aggressively. I have not been exposed to anyone. And I have had no symptoms. So I may not be someone who would immediately call up CHA to get tested. But someone who felt they had been exposed, knew someone who had it, maybe a coworker, even if it's like maybe a week or two ago, they would be like, even if they're not experiencing a symptom, they should maybe call up, you know what I mean? Because then CHA might be able to better track how it's working in the community. Yeah.
Right. Good information. Thank you, Julia. And then moving on to the issue of food security, which is an increasingly important one as these weeks go on. And as we see the rates of employment climb, we're approaching 20% unemployment nationwide right now, which is pretty scary. So food security is a big issue. What can you update us on that front with?
Sure. So this update is a little less today. I wrote this story last week, and so some of the statistics are a little bit older, even though it doesn't feel old, but they're working so hard and distributing so many meals every day that it feels like old news already. But as of May 4th, the city had distributed 29,202 meals through the school district to families, students, etc. And these are kind of like prepackaged meals. And then on top of that, The City Public Health Department, through the Shape Up Somerville Initiative, has also distributed, I think as of May 9th, 100,000 pounds of food, which they have been getting through the Greater Boston Food Bank and Food for Free in Cambridge. And that is really an amazing, amazing number. 100,000 pounds of food, and that is groceries more, while the 30,000 meals is more like prepackaged meals for families to count on during the week and over the weekend for their children, their student, et cetera. Mm. But this effort has been simply massive. There are volunteers. The city told me that there have been a number of staff members who have been redeployed to support this. There have been people in the school district, paraprofessionals who've been calling families to see what they need. People, you know, in other offices who would never kind of step into the health department who have been redeployed to support this effort, as well as volunteers in the community who have been manning those meal distribution centers at the schools throughout Somerville. So people are really, really coming together to get this done. And I think the reason for it, when I was talking to Director Doug Kress of the Board of Health, is that while, you know, there are some other food pantries in Somerville and our surrounding communities, they have a limited scope. And also not everyone can leave their homes. So part of the need gap that the city is really filling are the people who are quarantining and who are isolating and who cannot leave their homes, and they are delivering groceries to their front porch. But it's really amazing. Here are a few more amazing statistics. I'm trying to think of, they have distributed, I think, so in 1 week, the week of April 27th, they received 21,000 pounds of food from the Greater Boston Food Bank, distributed 4,209 meals to 846 households, which is almost 2,500 people. A lot of numbers, a lot of people, big effort. yeah, it's crazy to think about. And the other thing that is interesting but really makes sense is that they've seen a really high demand on Fridays, especially for those prepackaged meals as families kind of head into a weekend without quite as many support services as they do have during the week.
Right.
So that's just kind of one part of it. You mentioned you had heard something about what the Greater Boston Food Bank has been up to.
Yes. Yeah. I had a friend who posted 5 days ago on their Instagram, Tim Devin. I don't think he would mind if I mentioned his name, that he was volunteering at the Greater Boston Food Bank and had heard from one of their organizers that they had distributed more food over the past 8 weeks than they had in their previous 40 years, which is kind of phenomenal to think about, just the amount of demand for food right now, that, you know, some of us do take for granted, but, you know, you need to think of these newly unemployed, households, and, those with children as well. And that's probably where a lot of, I would guess that this is where a lot of the new demand is coming from. So
absolutely.
Really.
Yeah, when I was speaking with the Somerville Homeless Coalition a few weeks ago, they were saying that I think over 50% of the people they were seeing at their food pantry Project Soup were new people. And most of them were like out of work bartenders and, you know, just people who had never visited a food pantry before were now utilizing those services.
Hmm. And are there plans? Do you know of plans to continue the food program that the city is running to families over the summer?
I have not heard anything specific. I think, as you know, my impression is that they're going to keep doing this as long as they need to. Mm. So I think as far as food distribution goes, I think that is going to continue as long as it is needed because people are still going to be in isolation. I'm not entirely sure when it comes to the prepackaged meals, which are more geared towards families and children. But I mean, the school year traditionally goes through at least, you know, almost the end of June. So, you know, we're going to be seeing that continue for a while yet. And I, you know, our city's been so committed to this, I imagine they're going to come up with some ways to continue supporting families. One thing I do want to mention on that front is that I have heard from Director Kress that they are looking for volunteers. But I did want to mention, because he really emphasized that they are looking for volunteers who can volunteer on a consistent basis. And specifically, they are looking for drivers. So if you have a car and you're willing to commit to whether it's one afternoon a week or five afternoons a week, but you can commit to that one afternoon a week and they can count on you being there, you're really hoping to have a little bit more support and just getting these meals out to the community, because they keep on getting more requests for support and for need. So if you have that, if you can make that happen, they are in need of more people.
And that's a good segue to talking about the budget season. The city talking about their budget. And I know we were talking earlier about how cities are kind of struggling with a drop in what they take in. You know, city revenues come from a number of different things, depending on how it's structured city by city. You know, it could be sales tax, it could be hotel taxes. So we can anticipate a budget shortfall. So what else can you tell us about Somerville's budget?
Sure. So there's still a lot we don't know. I covered the school committee finance meeting on May 11th. And they were kind of covering the school side of this, but the school budget comes from the city budget. So they are, you know, tightly linked. And at that meeting, they were, the school's finance director was discussing just the kind of general lack of certainty around what revenue sources we're going to have, what other funding sources like grants, you know, federal funding from the CARES Act that's been made available, and when it's going to come in, what it can finance. There are a lot of questions still. But at the moment, the city is projecting about a 20% reduction in state aid, which is about a $7 million revenue loss for the city. And the city is also projecting a $5 million revenue loss from local revenues, which would be like your local hotel taxes, local motel taxes, parking fines, permits, et cetera. Which is pretty significant. I think he referenced a study from the Mass Budget and Policy Center, which studied how there had been a 25% revenue decline during the last 2 months, like March, April period. And it's projected to be even lower for May, June. And, you know, there are a bunch of other, you know, scary numbers that, you know, they're projected to be lower this year than forecasted and going into fiscal year 2021. Mm. So it's dire, you know, and I think the energy at that meeting was that, you know, the district and the city is really looking into any possible avenue. But at the same time, they are in a way dependent on state aid. So a lot of this is going to play out at state level, which is a lot more complex. And there are a lot more steps the state can take in terms of imposing different taxes on different income brackets, et cetera. So it's, I think really the outcome was like, we're not sure. And how the district is operating, how it's been recommended that they operate is that they decide on a level service budget, which essentially means that they have the same amount of services they had last year. So no increase other than the projected like cost of living increases, the what contracts require in terms of salary raises. And then they, on top of that, they plan for a 5%, a 3, 5, and 7% reduction in revenue. So they have all these different budgets that they're working on to like, depending on like what happens.
Yeah. Is there talk of furloughing or laying off city employees?
So not yet. So this was a school committee meeting. So, and I have not heard that yet. And one thing that the superintendent did say is that, unlike some other districts, the Somerville district has maintained all staffing. So during this period, no one has been furloughed, laid off, for this reason. It's still the plan to try to maintain staffing and core services. And that where some of the kind of where they've had to take away has to do with, you know, equity programs they were hoping to roll out. You know, those good things that the district wants to be doing, but, you know, in a situation like this may not be deemed necessary. Which is, I think, they, you know, it's a tough decision. It doesn't mean it's like, oh, we can just get rid of that. but at the same time, they want to be able to maintain those core services. So, you know, I think one thing they were discussing is that, you know, given that a lot of this is going to depend on the state action, the state can do a 1/12th budget, which is just a month at a time. They can do an emergency budget. They could do a 3-month budget. There are a lot of different kind of avenues our state legislature can take in terms of how to kind of plan for the like financial just kind of landscape of the next few months to a year. But that makes planning for a district or a city pretty difficult. So at the moment, it's I keep on saying this, no one really knows. No one really knows exactly what's going to happen. And even though the budget process is going to continue at the city level, you know, people are looking at it. I think the city's financial director is, you know, hard at work meeting with state finance people and city departments in terms of how they can cut costs. That there's still, the jury's still out on kind of what things are going to look like.
Yeah. And then wrapping up our update, you know, is there anything that you want to highlight that's come your way, come across your desk, or that, you know, anything that you've talked with to other people about? And while you think on that, I'll let you know that I've been talking with some businesses, some local businesses on a week-to-week basis, and in our Somerville Media Center business updates. And just hearing those stories, businesses are really, really struggling right now, and nonprofits as well. I should say a lot of them have adapted to a new kind of business model, a new kind of thing that they were creating that they weren't before, like Aeronaut creating hand sanitizer. It's interesting just to see, like, there's still a level of optimism and hope, especially as the city considers reopening in the next few weeks, and you know, things like possibly closing city streets so that restaurants can have that as a dining area potentially. You know, so they are optimistic, but it's a struggle for them. And you know, just putting the message out there to support your local businesses as much as you can right now, because they're facing, like all of us, they're facing something really unique.
No, I love that. Yes, I mean, I've heard the same. You know, people are getting so creative on the ground to kind of do anything. There's the owner of Back Bar and Union has been making like cocktail demos and asking for tips, which he's been giving to his out of work staff. There's a gift shop, which is like my favorite place ever, Davis Squared in Davis Square, which, you know, despite the fact that, you know, stores are closed and retail is closed and they don't even have a functioning kind of online like traditional shop. That they've been doing amazing business because they've been posting all this stuff to Instagram and people have been calling them. I may have called them and gotten my parents a birthday present. Mm-hmm. And just like, it's like a personal shopping experience, like weirdly, but it works and they're trying it and people are working with them, which is so cool. You know, there are businesses, so many restaurants right now are giving back, whether it's Himalayan Kitchen, who's doing lunches every Thursday, which in Assembly Square, which is donating food to Somerville Homeless Coalition and the labor that goes with it. There's Forge Baking Co., the owner of Forge, has raised $37,000.
Wow.
An amazing amount to finance meals, like prepared meals for Somerville residents, as well as residents, you know, in our area, working with community cooks. She's really amazing what they've been able to accomplish. There's, you know, the Bow Market Safe Supply, which is like, what is this? And they managed to create like a functioning outdoor farmer's market that is also social distanced and then raised like $3,000 for the Somerville Homeless Coalition to boot. Like people are really rising to the occasion, I find, for the most part. Or at least I'm clinging to those stories while we're all out here floundering.
Yeah, you have to. You have to.
Yeah, you really do. So I think, you know, even though this is tough and, you know, waking up and reading the news is hard and, you know, it's in no way, it in no way assuages the tragedy and loss of this pandemic, there are good people and there is good news out there. And especially in Somerville, I've been finding the more I report that, like, it's happening in every square, it's happening in every neighborhood. People are organizing around food, around mask making, just getting their neighbors, you know, groceries. So if you want to see some good stuff, look out your window, yeah. Open your door yeah. from a distance.
Yeah. Well, thanks again for speaking with me, Julia Taliesin from the Somerville Journal. Visit somervillejournal.com to read all of the latest happenings, to read more about what we've discussed today. And you can, if you're viewing this on Somerville Community Access Television, you can also view this on our video on demand at our website, somervillemedia.org, as well as our YouTube and Facebook and other social media. So thanks again, Julia.
Thanks.
Have a great week, and we'll talk to you soon.